A very good evening to everyone. On behalf of PG and Research Department of Biotechnology, Kongunado Arts and Science College, I welcome you all for the Indian Council of Philosophical Research, ICPR, sponsored 3 days virtual webinar series on philosophy of man, environment and sustainability. Jointly organized by Department of Biotechnology and Swami Vivekananda Study Circle, Kongunado Arts and Science College. It's our honor and pleasure to address such a distinguished group of eminent experts and scholars in various fields. Many of you have made a huge effort to join us today. On behalf of us, we deeply appreciate and offer you a most grateful welcome.
Prayers is beyond any question the highest activity of the human soul. Man is at his highest and greatest when on his knees. He comes face to face with God. Prayer is the rising of one's mind and heart to God or requesting of good things from God. Now, I call Kalpa Mukunda Ji and Kavya from 3rd BSc Biotechnology to invoke Almighty's blessing with a prayer song.
Vanagi 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 Vanagi
Thank you, Mukunda and Kavya. Welcoming newness, welcoming strength, welcoming charm, welcoming grace, welcoming power more than anything. Welcoming people is the most heartful asset of any great ceremony. First of all, I dedicate my welcome in absentia to our beloved president, Dr. M. Aruchami sir. I cordially invite Dr. S. R. Madan Shankar sir, Dean Academics, Head of the Department PG Biotechnology and convener of this program to welcome the gathering. Sir, please.
Good evening to all present here. Today we are here to listen to 3 days lecture series, webinar series on the philosophy of man, environment and sustainability. At the outset, it is my privilege and also I deem it a great pleasure in welcoming the president of this program, who is none other than our secretary and director, Dr. C.A. Vasuki. Madam has given lot of lectures about sustainability, environmental aspects and also how we have a connect between nature, man and also well-being. It's my pleasure to welcome you, ma'am, for this program and preside over the function. I cordially extend my welcome to the chief guest of this function, Dr. Hippu Crystal Nathan from Irma, Gujarat, who is going to speak on sustainability. Dr. Hippu has a long-standing experience and is a good field worker. And he's very busy, and despite his busy schedule, he has taken time to share lot of experiences which he had gained personally to all of us in terms of environment, sustainability and passing on a green and clean environment to our next generation. I welcome you, sir. I also welcome our beloved principal, Dr. M. Lakshmanaswamy sir, who is also my teacher, my guru, and from whom I had my humble beginnings at this institution. I welcome you, sir. I extend a very cordial welcome to the team of faculty members from the Department of Biotechnology, who have been a great source of inspiration, support, and courage and strength for all the activities that have been carried out from the department. I welcome each and every one of you for this program. I would be failing in my duty if I don't welcome in absentia the chairman of Indian Council of Philosophical Research, Shri R.P. Sinha Ji, and also the past chairman, Shri S.R. Bhatt Ji, who have been kind enough to sponsor this webinar series. And on behalf of the management and on behalf of the department, I owe a warm welcome to Dr. Sinha and also to Dr. S.R. Bhatt, who have been kind enough to fund this program, which is a need of the hour. The beneficiaries of the program, the students who are attending this particular program, needs a cordial welcome, because environment and sustainability is a need of the hour, and it is the duty of every one of us to see that the students are sensitized and students are made aware about the ill effects of overuse of environmental resources, and also how to pass on a sustainable environment to the next generation. I welcome all of you, and once again, it's my pleasure to welcome everybody who have joined this program. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. A strong woman stands up for herself. A strong woman stands up for everyone else. Here we have with us the strongest woman, one who feels deeply, one who is both soft and powerful. She, in her essence, is a great to the institution. Yes, she is none other than our beloved secretary and director, Dr. C. A. Vasuki ma'am. We are indeed grateful for her presence here, and we welcome her with whole of our heart to address the gathering. Ma'am, please.
Hello and good evening. To all my dear friends who have joined this virtual webinar today evening, which has been organized by the Indian Council of Philosophical Research and in New Delhi with our biotechnology department, and as well as our Swami Vivekananda study circle. So I'm very, very happy. Even though after a very long summer day, I think the heat is quite intense in Coimbatore at this time, when everything is winding down. Our beloved students, it's very nice to see more than 150 students have joined, which I'm very, very pleased here, because all these meetings and all these programs of are organized mainly for our younger generation, who are going to protect and keep our environment safe. Especially, it is very important, today's topic being sustainable development of this environment, and how man environment are very closely linked. So this is a very nice topic, and I think more than anybody, our young generation should know about this more. And it should, I'm sure, our the guest whom we have invited is Dr. Hippo Christian Nathan from IRMA Gujarat. And sitting from southern end of India, we admire Gujarat. Either it is politically or by sustainability or anything and everything, we are a great admirer the way your state has come up and as a role model for the entire Bharat. So we, the entire nation, have to learn a lot of lessons from you guys, and I'm sure you are going to today give us a very thought-provoking talk, especially to our younger students who have joined you eagerly. So with this, one thing, when Dr. Madan Shankar told me about this topic, the first thing that came across my mind is the quote from Osho. And I would like to repeat that to my dear friends. As Osho says, quote, "You are a guest. Leave this earth a little more beautiful, a little more human, a little more lovable, a little more fragrant for those unknown guests who will be following you." Isn't that a very powerful statement? And why it is important for us to be protecting our environment, and whatever development and whatever the greed and need of the society, we have to be very careful in not abusing the environment and our ecosystem. So when you see, a very strong word comes here in this topic, in the philosophy. When, for my dear young students, I will say, philosophy, oh, this is going to be something, some very deep-rooted, you know, thought-provoking subjects are going to be discussed. But no, what is philosophy when you see the fundamentals of knowledge, reality and existence is philosophy. So philosophy is, doesn't drop from somebody's mouth or some saint comes and talks us about philosophy. It is everything, like, you know, the knowledge, the reality and its existence. This is exactly what it means as philosophy. So when you see, you're all young science students, science and philosophy has its origins, I would very boldly state, science, its development and philosophy are very deep-rooted in this Bharat. Because, you know, the strong pillars of our ancient scriptures, and these scriptures are from the Vedas, the Upanishads, and also our great epics, all of them have given a very strong foundation in this continent. And all these, each and every thoughts, when you see, it has a very deep-rooted scientific meaning to it. So it's precisely when you see how this great Bharat Varsha and how this great Sanatana Dharma all exists, coexist. It is the Brahmam. Brahmam is nothing but pure consciousness. And what that is the basic principle of Sanatana Dharma. So it is the basis of the formation, the sustenance and the end of the universe. So all this, when you see, we are all very closely interconnected with nature. All our ways and practices, our way of living life itself is by giving mutual respect. All our rituals, when you see, it has always a very close connection with nature and environment. So, as Veda says, Sarvam Kalak Idam Brahmaha, which means pure knowledge is not means to an end, but the end itself. So, this is something which we all should know. How deeply our ancestors have thought about in everything, how they have incorporated. So our environment and our coexistence will be very sustainable in the longer run. Each and every today, like, you know, for in South India, I would say to my students very simply to understand every ritual. When you see, nama Aadi Padinettu appdin onnu irukku illaya, what is Aadi Padinettu? We all go to the river banks and we set the Navadaniyangal, that is the pulses, and we make them germinate and let them in the river water. It is for sustenance, and also in our store the grains. It is like, you know, today we keep them in cold storage to the important seeds. So if there is a natural calamity, if something goes wrong, we will have a seed bank. So similarly, each and every practices, I would say, has a very close connection for sustainability. And because of the greed of our human being in the name of civilization, long, long time ago, always there is a conflict between nature and human. Either it is for our materialistic liking and has become larger and larger. And because of that, we start to abuse nature. And that's one of the reasons today when you see, there is even in and around Coimbatore, and we see a lot of human animal conflicts going on. Human animal conflict is especially with elephants. It is because we are continuously encroaching their environment, and they are also having the rights to live in this world. Am I not right? So similarly, our human greed, what it has done, it has brought many new plant varieties into our country. And this has caused a great threat, environmental threat for our endemic species. So that's also something which we, for our tree, we are playing around with nature and environment. So today, I'm sure our chief guest, Hippo's Crystal Nathan, is going to give you a very beautiful talk about how development should be very sustainable and how man, environment are very closely linked. So with this short, small note of address, I would like to thank each one of you and enjoy the session. Not only today, it is going to be 3 days, and I'm sure you're all very fortunate and you're lucky that the Indian Council of Philosophical Research has given us a fund. Let's thank them as well. And let us thank your HOD, Dr. Madan Shankar, who has organized such thought-provoking lectures with very good people through and through. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Leaders are made, they are not born. They are made by hard efforts, which is the price which all of us must pay to achieve any goal that is worthwhile. We are delighted to welcome our principal, Dr. M. Lakshmanaswamy, sir, to deliver the felicitation address. Sir, please.
Thank you, madam. Most respected secretary and syndicate member of Bharatiya University, Dr. C. Vasuki, madam. And today, our eminent speaker, Dr. Hippo Crystal Nathan from Gujarat. And on March 17th, Dr. Sobha Reddy from Bangalore. And March 18th, Dr. N. Maganingam from Madhya Pradesh. Dr. S. Organizing Secretary, Dr. S. N. Madan Shankar, Dean Academics and Head PG Department of Biotechnology, faculty members, research scholars, PG and UG students, on behalf of the management, welcome all for the 3 days webinar on philosophy of man, environment and sustainability, jointly organized by Department of Biotechnology, Viva the Study Circle, Indian Council, sponsored by Indian Council of Philosophical Research, ICPR, sponsored webinar. Time is more precious. With this few introduction, I am also eagerly waiting for the chief guest speech. A very excellent topic, that is, being a biologist, I am more interested to learn the what is the sustainability, what sustainability is development. So thank you for the opportunity given to me. I wish the program a grand success. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I invite Dr. R. Satish Kumar, sir, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology, Kongunadu Arts and Science College, to introduce our chief guest. Sir, please.
Yes, thank you. Good evening, all of you. I welcome everyone for this gathering. It's my pleasure to introduce our chief guest, Dr. Hippo Salk Crystal Nathan. Hippo Salk Crystal Nathan is an engineer, current development researcher with an M.Tech in thermal engineering from the Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, and PhD in development studies from Indira Gandhi Institute of Development Research, Mumbai. Currently, he works as an assistant professor in the area of social science at the Institute of Rural Management, Anand, Gujarat. He won elsewhere National Academy of Science India Young Scientist Award 2017 in social science. He was the Subir Chowdhury Postdoctoral Fellow at the London School of Economics for the academic year 2016 and 2017. He won the GDN Awards and Medals Competition 2013 in the category of Outstanding Research on Development. He is a recipient of Young Scientist Award conferred at Odisha Environmental Congress 2012. His broad area of interest lies in energy, economic measurement, sustainable use of resources, and human development. His research work were published in several peer-reviewed journals. He has undertaken research projects sponsored by Global Development Network, Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, Development of Science and Technology,
South Asian Network for Economic Institutes, National Council for Science and Technology Communications, and Department of Tourism, and Indian Council of Social Science Research. Having such a wonderful resource person is our pleasure. Now I invite our eminent speaker to share his knowledge. Sir, now the floor is yours.
The only thing, thank you very much for this generous introduction, and thank you Dr. Madan for giving this opportunity. I always love to interact with students. I was also waiting for this occasion, and this is some topic which, though I have taught in various forms, or I have also done some of my research, but not in the way today I am going to present. I mean, this is what I have titled, as you have seen, sustainable development. What development and whose sustainability? I mean, when you talk of sustainable development, it is some is a word which people say it is overused. I mean, since the time of Brundtland Commission report of 1987, or you talk of 1992 Earth Summit, and following we have this sustainable development goals in 2015. And if you see this particular term, sustainable development, have been used, overused, some people also say abused in some way or the other. So now the question is whether we are true to the spirit of sustainable development, as your chairperson has already sort of mentioned this point. So whether we are becoming committed both in letter and spirit to the notion of sustainable development. So are there any misunderstanding in sustainable development or not? So that's what we are trying to we'll try to observe. The one okay, great. So thank you very much. So as the topic stands today, sustainable development, what development and whose sustainability? I again thank and be grateful to the organizers for giving me this opportunity. If we talk about development, so development is such a generic term. If you keep asking people what they mean by development, the conventional notion of development is something where people talk about the way they understand economic development, or in the sense the growth rate, the rise in personal income. People, in general, if you'll find even political parties, have debates around growth rate. I mean, for example, the erstwhile UPA government would say, well, in our times the growth rate was so much, the NDA time the growth rate has fallen. Or might the NDA used to say, well, UPA's growth rate was this much because the previous NDA government did good work and there was an effect of that on the UPA government, and therefore the UPA one had seen a growth rate of good growth rate from 2004 to 9, for instance. But 9 to 14, since UPA one didn't do good work, so UPA 2 growth rate was low. I mean, this is something which, even political, when the elections are fought, or when the political, leaders, they give speeches, or in general also policymakers talk about. The erstwhile Planning Commission or the Niti Aayog also gives their report. They essentially talk about growth rate. So one understanding of development is from the narrow economic view of looking at it as something which is in terms of the growth, or that is we are having in terms of the GDP, GNP. Now, if you, some people say, no, development is more about infrastructure development or more about urbanization. I mean, more about, some people might say at the end of the development, the fruit of development must reach to each and everybody. So in that sense, development is something where the basic needs of the individuals, need to be satisfied. So that is one way of looking at development, that access to basic quality of life can somebody, consider as development. And the third thing is can be, social modernization. I mean, in the sense, people might say development at the end of the day is something which is all about, having a broader mindset. For example, if in a pockets of our country, if honor killing happens, for instance, or the society remains essentially casteist, for instance, then you might able to argue that we all are having material well-being, or we are having development in the strict notion of having lot of monetary wealth, but then our mind is at the medieval level, in the sense we are a modern country with a medieval mindset. I mean, if for example society remained casteist, if there are prejudices, there are honor killing, if there are differences among people, then obviously it is true and it is valid that one can argue that development, you have not achieved development because you are not able to value liberal progressive mindset, for instance. So if you are not able to value that, then obviously development has not happened. I mean, in the same sense, I mean, development has been interpreted in various ways. For example, one of the most popular ways of interpreting development was through capabilities and freedom. So capabilities and freedom way of looking at development is something where, for example, sense capability approach, which some of you, whether you may know or not, I mean, I really wanted to have this session more interactive, but I don't know whether I can ask questions in between. Dr. Madan can confirm me. Can I ask question in between the students, or it has to be a monologue?
So you can continue a session, sir. At the end of your session, we'll have a Q&A session, sir.
Fine. Okay, fine. So basically, if you know, if some of you might be knowing the name Professor Amartya Sen, I mean, who is one of the Indians to get Nobel Prize, and that Nobel Prize was in economics. And one of the things which he is known for is the capability approach. So when you talk of development, it is basically essentially improving the capabilities. And when you talk of capabilities, people might ask, what is this capabilities all about? I mean, if we ask ourselves what we are currently doing, I mean, you are students in certain institute pursuing certain degree, for instance, okay, or I am a faculty here, at the Institute of Rural Management, Anand. And then if we ask, that we are and what we are currently doing, okay, we are having a kind of a session on the title that what is this development and whose sustainability we talk about when you talk about sustainable development. So, but if we ask ourselves, so this is what we are currently are and what we are currently doing. But if we ask ourselves, what else we could have done? Okay, if we ask this question, what else we could have done, then the answer could have been different. For example, some of you might have, maybe you are from Kerala and you had seen football in your neighborhood and you wanted to be a footballer, for instance, or somebody wanted to be a musician, for instance, or somebody would have been a writer, for instance. So if you think yourself that what else you could have been, okay, that is this set of things which you could have been or which you could have done and which you reason to value, in the sense which you like to do and which you can. I mean, these are the good things. I mean, these are not the bad things, for instance. These are very good things. Somebody cannot club, for instance, I wanted to be thief, for instance. So that those kind of options will not, because you cannot reason to value to be a thief. So you need to put options which you could have been or which you could have liked to do or liked to be, and that is nothing but your capability set. And sense capability set, sense capability theory says that the capability set, these options of being and doing, these options of being and doing should be as large as possible. And when I say the option of being and doing should be as large as possible, that basically also says indirectly that I need to have the opportunities to have those beings and doings. For example, if you are not from Kerala, if you are from a hilly place where there is no football is played in the neighborhood, there is no football coaching is available, then obviously that particular opportunity is not available. Therefore, that is a thing which you could not have realized if you would have wished to have that. So therefore, that will not come into the capability set. So when Sen says, if you look at development from the capability theory point of view, he would say that your capability set should be large, which otherwise says that your, you know, opportunities should be available. I mean, it is, so for example, if you see, I mean, if you go to foreign universities, or you might have heard that people can opt for, you know, music and mathematics, for instance. I mean, the idea is your, you know, the infrastructure around, the systems around, the institution around need to provide the opportunities. Of course, the choice one makes, that is up to the person, but then opportunity should be there. So one way of looking at development is that the capability set should be large. And also there is a second part to this theory of capability is that, you know, what you finally want to be or what you finally want to do must be driven by your free choice. Okay. So it should not be driven by prejudices. Like, for example, somebody should not say, though you wanted to be, I mean, you could have been happy with doing X, Y, G or A, B, C, but you have to do C because, you know, this is what our family is doing. Therefore, you have to do C. You don't have to, you yourself don't have an independent choice, but you have to do this. Or you belong to this caste. Therefore, you have to be, you know, some, you know, you have to only do that, this particular thing. Or you belong to this gender, you are a girl, for instance, or you're a boy, for instance. So because you are a girl or because you are a boy, therefore you have to do this thing. I mean, so the capability set or capability theory, the theory of capability, you know, idea of development from that theory has basically two parts. One is your capability set should be large. And the second part is of the capability set, what you want to choose, that choice must be driven by your free will. So one can see development in that aspect. Of course, one can also see development in the aspect of satisfaction and happiness. I mean, you might know that there is a country in our neighborhood which actually measures its progress not through GDP, GNP, gross domestic product or gross national product, or not per capita income. That basically measures progress in terms of happiness. Some of you might know it is Bhutan, which actually measures countries' progress through something called gross national happiness, GNH. I mean, if some of you are interested, you can look for it. If you need also some literature, you can get in touch with me. I can share you some of the, you know, the way the GNH actually evolved. Actually, you can get some of the literature in the internet as well. So one can see development in multitude of ways. Now, you know, if I ask you one particular question here, probably I need some response. I mean, I don't know whether people can, you know, people can write in the chat box, right? If I may ask Dr. Madan, can they not write something in the chat box? Can they type something in the chat box? I think they can, right? Dr. Madan?
Yes, Dr. Hippu.
Yeah, so I'm just saying if somebody wants to write something in the chat box,
they can do that. Yes.
Fantastic. Yeah. Okay. So this is something I really want some response from them, because it is very difficult to proceed this slide without getting responses. So here I want to ask, you know, all the students who are here, I mean, who are kind enough to join, I'm giving you a particular scenario to understand how development can be thought in various aspects. So the scenario is the following, that you are there in, you know, in the decision-making position. The world is consisting of only you and three children. Please remember this, the world is constituting of you and three children. And these three children are fighting for a flute. The child A says, I am the one who knows how to play it. And child B says, I am the one who doesn't have any other toy to play. And when a child A says that I am the one who knows how to play it, you ask child B and C, child B and C agree to that we don't know how to play. It is only the child A who knows how to play it. After all, it is a flute. It needs to be played. The child B says, I don't have any other toy to play. And child B and, you know, child C and A agree to that. And child C says, I am the one who made it. I mean, there is no dispute about that child C has made it. So child C has made it, child A and B agree to that fact that child C has made it. Now they are fighting for the flute, claiming ownership on that, because child A knows how to play it, child B doesn't have any other toy to play, and child C is the one who has made it. They have come to you, you have to give the flute to one of the children. You cannot keep it to yourself. Now I request each one of you to give your response, whatever thought comes to your mind in a 10 seconds, which child you want to give the flute. And I hope I can see your response in the chat box. Or if you want to unmute and speak also, that is fine with me. I mean, if it is fine with the organizer, you can quickly unmute and speak, but you need to tell me, yes, I am getting the chat box responses. Please go ahead. Which child you are going to give? Child A says, I am the one who knows how to play it. Child B and C agree to this fact. Child B says, I don't have any other toy to play. Child A and C agree to that. And child C says, I am the one who made it. So which child you are going to, I am the one who took the pain to basically build this flute. Okay. So therefore I deserve the ownership. Child B is saying, I don't have any other toy to play. And child A is saying, you know, I'm the one who knows how to play it. Yeah, you are 90 of you here or 100 of you here. I mean, that's what I'm seeing here. And I've just got three responses, please. Whatever you think, if you can, or you want to unmute and just speak up, which child you want to give the flute to?
Child A.
Child A. Okay, fine. Fine. Indu.
Yes, Indu Jodha.
Yeah, fine. Next, anybody, please mute yourself. Others, please.
Students, can you unmute yourself and speak? Are you quiet? Yeah. You're also quiet.
Yeah, even Dr. Madan, if you don't mind, which child you would give it? Okay, it is not for the students. Which child you want to give?
Child B.
Child B. Okay. Okay. Vasuki ma'am, whom you want to give?
The C. Child C, because he has been working on the flute for months, so I feel that child deserves it.
Child C. Okay, fine, fair enough. So we have at least one count of child C and child B. Okay, B. Very good. Yeah, Vidya has also said child C. Yes.
Child C, sir.
Students can unmute and answer.
Yeah, please go ahead, unmute and answer. Yeah, one by one.
Let it be interactive. Please unmute and answer.
Yeah, most of you, some of you who have put in the chat is child A, but Vidya has said child C. Yes. Kathy,
any child A.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, just few seconds more. You have the opportunity to give your answer. See which child you have to give. You imagine you are in a situation where nobody is there. It is only you and three children. They came crying to you, fighting for a flute. Child A claims, I know how to play. Child B says, I don't have any other toy to play. Imagine the person is a child and he or she doesn't have any other toy to play. Child C says, I am the one who made it. Okay, whom would you give?
Sir, child B, sir.
Child B. Okay, some of you are saying child B. Okay, quickly, just type A, B, even you do not write. Type also child.
Child A, sir.
Child A. Okay, good. Okay. Yes. So, Madan sir is saying B. Yeah. So anyway, so that's what, you know, our response is. Some of you want to give response still, you please go ahead. I will just wait for another 10 seconds. Yeah. Yes, so don't, you know, I'm basically asking your independent thought. Don't think that you know, somebody has answered that, therefore we have to answer. Probably A got a lot of answers because somebody answered A, and probably I said it is a flute, it has to be played. Okay, I mean, I don't know, I mean, whether you have got influence. I'm just asking for your independent view. Okay, so yes, now if we see, I mean, see, even this particular, you know, sort of example I have tried in my classes a lot of time. Even if I'm tried, even also among my PhD students who are very less, I mean, maybe in a class of six or so, or even less, class of five, I generally get a divided house. Okay, I generally get a divided house. Some people would prefer A, quite rightly so, because it is a flute. As I said, a flute, if not played, what is the value of a flute? It's child A knows how to play. The child A has the skill. Child B doesn't have any other toy to play. I mean, this is a very serious thing. Because in you remember our childhood times, we need toys to play, and you know, at least the stick, you know, a flute in form of a stick is something which would be useful for child B, because child B doesn't have any other toy to play. And if you talk about child C, he has, as Vasuki ma'am was saying, he has or she has taken a lot of pain to make it. I mean, this is something which probably he or she deserves first. It doesn't matter whether somebody has it or not, or whether it doesn't matter whether somebody knows how to play it or not. Probably the person who took the pain to make it, probably he or she deserves that. Well, the idea is all of us are right, okay? And depending upon what is our thought process. Like Dr. Madan said, he prefers child B. When this question was asked to me by one of my professors, I preferred child B. The people who are, you know, who are preferring child B over others are generally egalitarian in their approach, in the sense they basically want a more equitable world. The result of development must be equity. I mean, the resources, the opportunities, it must be more equitably distributed. And that's what they basically want to say development is all about. People, overwhelmingly large number of people in this group actually preferred A, are the people who are utilitarian in their approach. In the sense, they want to see how much the society is gaining at the end of the day, you know, from the resources they have. So in the sense, if they're preferring child A, because after all, the flute will get its value only when it is in the right hand who basically knows how to play it. The people who are supporting child C are the people who are, I'm so sorry, is there a doubt or something? So the people...
No, Dr. Hippo, I have a doubt.
Yes, please.
Now, let's say you're giving it to child B. The child B is poor, yes, and he has no other toy of his own to play with. Yes. Now, yes. Won't it be appropriate to give something to a child who does not have it, but then maybe who will value it because he has possessed it?
I'm not siding with one or the other, but this is what I'm trying to say, that we all think differently. Okay, so okay, this is okay. What our perspectives of development. Okay, obviously, obviously a person who doesn't have any other toy to play would probably value it much more. If you ask for about valuing it, obviously the child who doesn't have any other toy, that particular stick is going to be, you know, everything for that child, because that is the only toy he or she has. So why we, you know, tend to think that person will not value it? The value of a thing, it doesn't depend how other is valuing it. Maybe, you know, playing a flute has a more value, but for that child, since that child doesn't have any other toy, if he would get or she would get that toy, probably he or she would be much, much happier, right? So the valuation would be entirely subjective, okay? So the idea is that people actually think development from multitude angle. So people who think tend to go towards child C, they basically think from the point of view of the, they call it libertarian approach. The liberty in the notion of Marx, that the people who have put in labor, the fruits of development must go to them. That's what Vasuki ma'am was mentioning, that, you know, since the child has taken a lot of pain, therefore the fruit of development must go to that. I mean, this is what, I mean, brilliance of Sen. I mean, Sen actually coined this example, and I have tested this example in various forums. I have found generally the house would be divided. And this is something which is very sentimental, and this actually brings the point very emphatically that development is not a one-dimensional thought process. I mean, that, you know, the ideas can come from various sides. Of course, I mean, in real life, we are not you know, we are not encountered with such tricky example. For example, in real life, suppose I say, I you know, convert this example from fruit to a food item, for instance. And now, suppose child A says, I am the one who gets maximum pleasure of eating it. Okay. Child B says, I don't have any other food to eat. And child C says, I am the one who made it. And if you have to want to make a decision who should get the food, then probably in that case, what would be our answer? Any thought? Any thought? If it would have been food, child A is the
B.
one.
I think B.
B, sir.
Yeah, B. Yeah, exactly. So that's basically it is about food. So food, obviously, if the person doesn't get food, obviously that person will not lose life. So therefore, yes. And suppose I say, you know, I convert this example to a scholarship, for instance. Now, this is a scholarship for, you know, finding a very, very effective vaccination for coronavirus, for instance. And child A knows how to do it, for instance. And child B doesn't have any other scholarship. And child C is the one who actually did the legwork. When the scholarship sponsor came, he went to the airport to bring them and actually facilitated the process. So which child should get it or which student should get it?
C. As far as I'm concerned, C.
Which student should, ma'am, just let me repeat the example. The student A actually is the most competent student to work on the scholarship and find a solution. Okay. Student B doesn't have any other scholarship. And student C is the one who did the legwork for facilitating this scholarship. So who should get the scholarship? Since we're talking about, you know, something like coronavirus or something like, for example, a solution to cancer or something like a dreadful disease, and somebody has a solution to disease, obviously you might, I mean, when actually also I have tested this example, even one of my professors has also tested this example, most of the people will side with A. Most of the people will side with A because this is about, you know, the utility aspect of the development will take over or the egalitarian and the libertarian aspect. Suppose in a third example, suppose I say for example, there is a, you know, flight, you know, transportation, you know, sort of started from one city to other city, you know, for example, one city in Tamil Nadu, for example. So one city started a flight from, you know, local flight from one place to the other. Now there is a free seat. That free seat should go to whom? Well, the person A is the one who enjoys flight travel the most. The person B who has never gone in flight, or the person C who has actually made the effort to have that flight travel possible, that flight transportation possible. Probably in that context. Okay, in that context. So you want to reward the person, right? I mean, in one. So the person A is the one who enjoys the flight travel most. Okay, that is the person A. So he gets the maximum utility out of that travel. Child B is the one, or the person B is the one who actually, you know, have not traveled in flight. So that is the child B. And C is the one, or the person B, and the person C is the one who has actually made this entire thing possible. In the sense, this flight is travel, what has happened, for example, E. Sridharan, when he started the metro, it is under his able leadership, a metro travel is made possible, for instance. Okay, something like that. So he is the person who is behind this travel to, you know, this particular facility to come about. Then whom do you give? Okay,
I'll go for C.
So in such occasions, obviously you try to reward the person because they are so real life examples are more like that. Therefore, we are in a more you know, decisive framework in terms of whom to give. But here also, you know, I got one answer as B. Sometimes what happens is the egalitarian aspect that, well, if there is somebody who has never traveled in flight, let me actually give that, you know, ticket to that person. Okay. So the idea is we actually, you know, think differently, and therefore we see development differently. So that was my whole point in bringing this sense flute example. Now, if you talk about development, you'd see, you know, looking development from an economic angle to something what, you know, even Vasuki ma'am was saying in the beginning, there has been actually two paradigm shifts. So one shift is to the shift to human development, and the other is basically shift to the sustainable development. And there we will learn, you know, what development is and whose sustainability is. See, when you talk of human development, I mean, this is something which has not a very long history. I mean, which, of course, started with, you can say, you know, in 1990, the United Nations Development Report, UNDP actually came out with something called Human Development Report. United Nations Development Program, UNDP, the organization basically came out with human development reports. So that is the first time they brought out and they started ranking countries in terms of Human Development Index. So if you look at the traditional way of looking at development, you all might agree with me. In traditionally, we say we need humans as actually resource. I mean, that's how we have HRD ministry. We had HRD ministry, which has been now converted to education ministry. But traditionally, if you have solved this, you know, in some of you have some economics background, you have some solved this production function. In the production function, you say this is labor, this is capital, and then labor, capital, maybe land, maybe financial resources, all that is basically add up to make something called, you know, interact with each other to make some production process. So humans are actually looked at as a means of development. I mean, if something has to be produced, human beings are needed as somebody who is contributing to this production process. Also, at sometimes human beings are also looked at from a social work point of view. They are looked at beneficiaries. They are looked at those who would be, you know, the benefit or the charity need to be provided. I mean, that is two ways, basically the traditional way of looking at human beings. But the human development paradigm actually had a shift. They started looking that human beings are at the center of development, in the sense they are not only the means of development, but they are ends by themselves. So what they said is, finally, the goods and the services are merely goods possessed by human being. But what is the human being are using those goods to for various satisfaction of theirs, various well-being of theirs, that is what actually is development is all about. So in that sense, they said freedoms. I mean, that is what, you know, Amartya Sen's 1999 book, Development as Freedom, essentially says, that freedoms are both primary aims as well as principal means to development. So when we said, when you looked at development from the capability approach, I said our capability should be large as possible. I mean, I could be this. I could have been a writer. I could have been a cricket player. I could have been a musician. I could have been a, you know, for example, a philosopher. I could have been, you know, whatever I wanted to be. So you know, these are the various options I have. If my family doesn't restrict me, so society provides me a lot of opportunities, then obviously my capability set would be large, right? And then what I finally choose. So therefore, it is not only about having that as an end goal, but also how do you reach to that end, the means aspect of it. And what I'm choosing out of my capability set, that should be also driven by free will. So in that sense, you know, the development can be said as a process of expanding these freedoms. I mean, why Amartya Sen was saying this, and Amartya Sen was quite moved by this notion of freedom, because it has to do with his own personal experience. I mean, if you get a chance, or some of you might have read the book Development as Freedom, you will come to know about one personal incident he writes when there was a riot situation in a you know, in the erstwhile, I think that time it was India and Bangladesh was one and the same, in the part of the same country, and there was a kind of a riot situation. I mean, I think it is pre-independence or post-independence, around the same time there was a riot situation. And during that riot situation, a Muslim gentleman had to come to the Hindu community area in search of work, because that is the area he generally comes, you know, every day on a daily basis he comes for his livelihood, requirement. So what happened? And in the process, actually, he gets stabbed. And Amartya Sen witnessed that, and though he cries for help, I mean, of course, you know, then the Amartya Sen being a child, he witnessed that, and he also screamed for help, and help arrived, but then the person was taken to the hospital, but subsequently the person dies out of his injuries. Now the question is, there was political unfreedom at that point in time because of the riot situation. So it was a kind of a curfew kind of situation in that area, or you can say there was a restriction in terms of movement. But when this political unfreedom was there, then obviously the economic unfreedom of the person, that the person doesn't have food to eat. I mean, if he doesn't venture out, he would be, you know, he has to sleep empty stomach. That actually pushed the person to take risk and go out onto the roads. And actually, if two unfreedoms together, both political and economic, actually created a situation in which the person has to lose his or her life. I mean, that does happen. For example, in this corona pandemic time also, all of us must have witnessed how, for example, migrant laborers, I mean, had to walk miles, you know, on barefoot and with their whatever little belongings or so, I mean, across the country. I mean, this is something which we observed. See, the idea was that, well, the country was in lockdown, but then who can sustain lockdown? Who can be okay with lockdown? You know, probably those who are slightly affluent, those who can order things, those who can get services at their doorstep, probably they could afford to, you know, sustain the lockdown. But those who could not, I mean, they obviously had to take risks. And those risks you might also have come to know that in the process they might have lost. So the idea is, so what is development? So development is actually expansion of our freedom or curtailment of our unfreedoms. And that's what Sen would write, that, you know, our unfreedom, that is our inability to satisfy hunger, our inability to treat for illness, our inability to be adequately clothed, our inability to have clean water sanitation, our lack of social arrangements, our denial of political or civil rights is something which is, you know, when you say are our unfreedoms, and these unfreedoms must be made less and less. And then, you know, that's what, you know, when you say focus on development would be basically, you know, thinking about, you know, having more and more expansion of those freedom. I mean, if you see, for example, in the Human Development Report, the very first, you know, this is UNDP 2001 report, which is the second report actually, that says basically what is human development. The UNDP itself defines it as, you know, person to lead a long and healthy lives, to be knowledgeable and to have access to the resources needed for decent standard of living, and to be able to participate in the life of community. I mean, the idea is, at the end of the day, you know, what development you are having is for the people. Okay, in the sense, if you want to compare between two societies, for instance, whether society A is more developed or society B is more developed, you basically look at their human beings. The particular society in which human beings are able to lead a life which they can reason to value, they are able to lead a long, healthy life, they are able to lead a life, or they have to get the pleasure of knowledge, and they are able to, you know, achieve a decent standard of living, then obviously you would say that society is better than the other. So that, I think, that is in that sense, the human development paradigm itself brought this, you know, brought this a shift in the way people looked at development. Otherwise, the narrow view of development is to compare countries, you know, GDPs or the societies, you know, you calculate which district is more developed, you basically calculate district gross domestic product, for example, or state gross domestic product, and see which, you know, GDP per capita is higher. I mean, that is actually looking development in a very, very narrow sense. And if you see, the sense capability approach is not a very new thing. In fact, if you look at Aristotle, what he said 350 BC, I mean, many, many thousand, I mean, like at least, you know, 2,500 years before, is something which is similar. That another belief which harmonizes with our account is that the happy man lives well and does well, for we have practically defined happiness as a sort of good life and good action. So when, you know, when Aristotle says about good life and good action, I think Sen, when Sen says about, you know, the being and the doing, and the being and the doing which you reason to value is basically nothing but good life and good action. So in that sense, I mean, that is, of course, so since, you know, we are in a, you know, philosophical research, you know, webinar, and then we wanted to understand what development means philosophically. You can see from the human development angle, it means actually in a situation or in an environment where you are able to lead a decent life. Of course, I mean, how do you operationalize this human development, you know, process? I mean, one of the ideas actually of operationalizing human development comes from Rawls' idea. I mean, some of you who have read John Rawls, I mean, whose work also inspired a lot Amartya Sen, was something who is considered as, you know, somebody who started this humanist revolution. I mean, in 1971, he wrote that book of the Rawls' Theory of Justice, which talked about the social primary goods. I mean, this is something very simple. I mean, if you understand Rawls, I mean, of course, this is a big fat book. I thought I just put it in one slide, but the crucial point of understanding is the following. Suppose we are, you know, roughly 90 of us here, and these 90 of us, or maybe more than 100 of us here, I believe. So we are basically given the task of, you know, finding the principles of our country, okay, or any society. Now, we belong to a particular college. All of us, suppose, belong to a particular college. Suppose you all belong to a particular institute, I believe. And suppose tomorrow you have been asked, all of you have been asked, to devise the rules and regulations for your institute. The rule of the game is that you come to this virtual room, that is, this is the room which we are in. And when you go out of this virtual room, the idea is you could be anybody. You could be one of the person who is working as a gardener of the college, or you could be a student of the college, or you could be a person who is heading the college, or you could be somebody as a faculty of the college, or you could be anybody. You could be somebody who is working in the canteen of the college. The idea is you are framing rules and regulations for the college campus, for instance, and you can be anybody in that campus. Once you go out of this room, you can be anybody in the campus, but you don't know what you are going to be. So that's what in the Rawls theory of justice talks about, the veil of ignorance or the original position. It basically says that all of us come to the original position where we don't know what was our past and what would be our future. In the sense, if I'm going to go out of this room, in which role I am going to participate in the society, that I am completely ignorant about. So if that is the situation, so we basically, you know, then we sit together and basically we are deciding what should be the rules. Now you can very well appreciate, if we don't know what we are going to be, then obviously the kind of rules we will set is, first and foremost set of rules which we'll keep is something called equal basic liberties. In the sense, we will definitely give equal rights to the people, right? I mean, irrespective of, for example, if you see, you know, Indian Constitution's fundamental rights, or US Bill of Rights, or for example, the fundamental rights given by the United Nations, you know, Commission of Human Rights, for example. So all this, so that Declaration of Human Rights. So all these basically comes under the notion of equal basic liberties, because irrespective of you are, you know, the big industrialist like Mr. Ambani or Adani, or you are a person on the street, okay, you have equal rights as far as voting is concerned, or if you have rights to right of freedom of speech and expression. So that you are going to give, because you don't know what kind of position you are going to occupy once you are out of this, this virtual room where you are here to, as a rulemaking body, as a member of the rulemaking body. So this is the original position. So in this original position, the very first thing you will do is basically you will give equal basic rights to everybody. And the second thing is you will do is you will try to see that the social, that there would be inequalities, because inequalities is not completely avoidable. So because obviously inequalities it would be there, because people would have different capacities. I mean, all the students given equal kind of education will rise to different level. depending upon their own capacity, for instance. So inequalities would be there, but the inequalities must satisfy two conditions. So one is the equality of opportunity, that if somebody wants certain opportunity, that opportunity must be available to the person. So in that sense, there should be equality and opportunity. But the second condition of the second principle is what actually Rawls is most known for, is the difference principle. If there is any inequality in opportunity, Rawls would say that inequality, in the first condition, it says that there should be equality of opportunity. But suppose you need to put certain inequality in opportunity, then obviously that inequality of opportunity must be directed to the disadvantaged. In the sense, so among the different, you know, persons, suppose you want to say there should be some inequality, obviously you might have seen this, you know, a beautiful image where the three persons standing and trying to see a match which is happening behind the wall, and the person's heights are different. One person is able to see without any support, for instance. Another person actually need a support of, you know, a height of one stool, for instance. The other person needs height of two stool to actually see the, you know, what is going on behind the other side of the wall. So now if I have three such chairs to basically give, if I equally distribute, obviously, you know, that would not be actually giving every person the opportunity to see what is happening behind the wall. Probably I need to give two chairs or the two stool height, what is needed for the person two, and then the one which is needed, you know, the one to the person who needs one, and the other person anyway is seeing the match without any support. So the three distribution, so that is what we call it, you know, in a sense, equity. So equity is something which we call, it's a kind of equality of opportunity. And then again, within that equality of opportunity, if you have some bit of inequality, that inequality must be, you know, inequality must satisfy the condition that the most disadvantaged should. It's basically, it's called Maximin rule, you know, or the difference principle, where the greatest benefits should go to the least disadvantage. So when I say greatest benefit to the least disadvantage, please don't confuse with the fact that, you know, like, for example, if I say, if there are, I mean, I'm giving a simple example. If there are three individuals, okay, so one person has 1 rupee, another person has, suppose, you know, 3 rupees, and the third person has, suppose, you know, like 10 rupees. So 1, 3, 10. Okay, now you have 5 rupees to distribute. How do you distribute? Any idea? How do you give 5 rupees to these three people? Or if you want to give it equally, let me put that as 6 rupees, so that you can, you know, if somebody wants to give it equally, maybe 2, 2, 2. So let me give that figure as 6 rupees. So you have 1, 3, and 10, and you have 6 rupees to distribute. Okay, so how do you distribute? Anybody, please? Any idea? Yeah, any idea? Anybody? Yeah, so the what I'm trying to say is, you know, when I say, so any one of you want to speak up or say anything? How do you want to distribute? You can unmute and say. Yeah, so the what I'm saying is, the idea is that you make the distribution in such a way, like, for example, you see, if you want to go by the difference principle or the Maximin rule, the idea would be following. You first come to the person who has the least number of endowment or least amount of endowment. So basically, the person who has the least is the person who is having 1 rupee. So you give that person, so you had 6 rupees to distribute. So you give that person, for example, 2 rupees, you know, so that person goes to the next level. Okay, so that means both of the, now the bottom two are actually 3 and 3. And then whatever is left with you, you are left with actually 4 rupees more, because 2 rupees you already given, that 4 rupees you split among the two. So basically the difference principle would say that you start from the bottom and then you go up and you go to the next level and then you start giving equally, then that those two people go to the next level. So this is something like that. So this is something which is actually, which is very important. I mean, from which the, you can say the human development paradigm sort of got influenced, but you know, there is something which is, it is not that human development index, for instance, or the human development measurement has actually captured all that. I mean, for example, inequality is not naturally captured in the, in, into the HDI. Okay. Now, if you see, if you look at human development, obviously you might want to see that there are things like this. For instance, you know, you are, I hope you are able to see this slide where it is saying about, you know, resources. You know, suppose certain people have resources. So our conventional way of looking at development was resource centric, that how much of resources we have. But you know what Amartya Sen and his colleagues actually contributed is something called capacity, because resources doesn't automatically get converted into actions. And of course, actions might give us utility. Like, for example, if you have a bicycle, the bicycle, if you want to ride the bike, if you know how to ride the bicycle, you ride the bicycle and then you go to a friend's place. That is the action you have, and then probably have lunch there, and that gives you some kind of pleasure, for instance. Now, the idea of development is that the development is not, you know, need to be focused on resources, because having a bicycle is not enough. What you need at the end of the day is to the capacity to ride the bicycle. So that way, you know, capacity is important. Similarly, actions is not important as such. If you see, there are two people who are fasting. I mean, sorry, two people who are sleeping empty stomach. One might be fasting, but one might be starving. So there is a difference. The person who is fasting had the capacity to eat, but that person is fasting out of his own or her own will. Whereas the person who is starving, the person needed food to eat, but then person is, you know, going empty stomach because he or she doesn't have any other food, any food to eat. So therefore, so if you look from the action point of view, obviously it is not a good idea to focus on the actions. Conventional notions of development have actually, you know, fixed on these ideas. Whereas utility, again, utility is not also a great thing. I mean, happiness is not a very great thing to look at. Of course, it actually looks as an end goal, but if you find there are people who feel, there are people who are, you know, like, for example, somebody who has got jail because of some revolution and they feel happy about it, in the sense, so their freedom might have got restricted, so their movement has been restricted, so they will not, but since cycle, so there may be certain psychological aspects for which people may feel happy about various constraint situation also. Therefore, only focusing on the happiness or the utility may not be a good idea. But if you look at, you know, overall, I mean, you might think that human development has achieved a lot, but then human development has missed a thing also. For example, the missing link of human development is the environmental aspects. So, you know, there was a paper in the Nature journal. I mean, if some of you are interested, you can look at this paper, which was titled "Time to Stop Celebrating the Polluters." So what used to happen is the countries which used to occupy the best ranks in the HDI index, the human development index, are the countries which were the most polluting also. So in the sense, so the what was happening was, since the human development index was focusing on health, education and per capita income, these three as the three dimensions, then obviously it was not looking at something which was relating to the environment. So that part which was missing. And if you go to the sustainable development, this is what something was captured. I mean, just to conclude on the human development thing, it was like, you know, when you translate from the natural capital, this is basically your resources, and natural capital actually goes to the built-in capital, and built-in capital finally makes your human capital, and then finally the happiness. So human development was somewhere here. which is basically talking about the human capital. And this is what is the Daly's continuum that basically says how ultimate means gets converted to intermediate means, and intermediate means get converted to intermediate ends, and then the ultimate ends. So if you talk about, you know, the difference between the human development and the other paradigm shift which happened in the sustainable development, the sustainable development actually, you know, talked about environment, because sustainable development, you know, had its origin with the Limits to Growth book, where people talked about that if, you know, the way, I mean, that's what, you know, Vasuki ma'am was also mentioning in the beginning, that, you know, the way the development is happening, it has been, you know, ignoring the nature, for instance, particularly the modern way of looking at development. So the Limits to Growth book actually highlighted this in a very emphatic way, saying that this increasing world production and consumption cannot go on the rate it is going on, because that would lead to environmental collapse. And therefore, if you see, you know, there was a International Union Conservation Nature report, 1980 report, which was titled World Conservation Strategy. It had these two pictures, as you see in the slide. So one is obviously, it was saying, I mean, it came out in 1980 and it talked about what would happen by 2020. I mean, where human influence on the nature would be very high. As you saw in 1980, it was maybe less, but as the time progresses, the human influence will become more and more. And then also it had another figure which actually talked about the inequality that is within the human society. It says, for example, one Swiss is equal to 40 Somalis. So basically, this is something which basically we need both inter and intergenerational equity. I mean, some of you might have already known about sustainable development, where people say sustainable development is that development which doesn't compromise the development of the future generation while attaining the development of the present generation. So it talks about, in that sense, intergenerational equity. It also talks about intragenerational equity, because within a generation also there has to be enough equality or equity among people. So in that sense, you can say sustainable development has gone a step forward in terms of, you know, achieving so all these sustainable development goals. It basically talks about these different aspects of development which is not inimical to environment, in the sense the environmental goals must be also we must have. For example, if you see, I mean, the one, you know, there are people actually put sustainable development paradigms in different way. One way is like economy, ecology and society are interacting with each other as separate entity, but they have an interaction effect. One way they put economy and society interacting, and both of them as a part of ecology. But I think the most plausible one is the economy is part of the society and the society is part of the ecology. I think this is something which actually makes more sense. And if you see in that way, if any system is there, the systems, I mean, if you can imagine any system, you can think of any system, whether it is a physical system, mechanical system, or any system, the system is taking some input and it is giving you desirable output and it is giving you waste. You can do it for any general system. Anything which you come to my mind, you can actually fit in here. Requiring input, giving desirable output and waste. So what you are attaining over time is your desirable output per input should be more and more, and your waste per input should be less and less, right? But that is what is called as efficiency. So you can call that as system efficiency or economic efficiency, but efficiency is not the only goal to be achieved. While you are being efficient, you also need to be equitable. And that is where the social well-being aspect will come. And then while you are efficient and equitable, you have to be environmental friendly. So in that sense, ecological acceptability would come. So these are basically the three dimensions of sustainable development. Any lecture on sustainable development must be talking about economy, society and ecology, or they call in the, you know, business term, people, planets and profit. So that profit is economics, people is social, and planet is environment. So these three dimensions is, you know, kind of an universal definition of sustainable development. But I'm trying to say this, you can say as economy part of the society, because if you see, nobody per se take money from the, you know, poor and give it to the rich. literally nobody goes and takes money from the poor. It is certain economic aspects in the society which brings in this inequality. So in that sense, economy is part of the society. Similarly, nobody per se bursts carbon dioxide, you know, balloons in the air to increase pollution. It is certain economic activities which leads to this pollution. So in that sense, thinking in this way, that economy part of the society, society in turn part of the ecology, actually is a good way. Then actually you can map this three dimension to sustainable development. But if you think what is missing in sustainable development, I mean, it is again, you might say that this is the end goal. But here I wanted to bring in this huge sustainability to the fore. Because, of course, Brundtland Commission report had its limitation. It talked about, you know, intergenerational equity, didn't talk about intragenerational equity. So that anyway, we understand sustainable development also means, you know, intragenerational equity. The second thing, the problem with the definition of sustainable development was, it was talking about, again, only human civilization. It was not essentially talking about all other species, for instance. I mean, it is saying the future gen, I mean, you have the development, you have the satisfy the needs and the aspirations of the present generation without compromising the needs and the aspirations of the future generation. When you talk about present generation and future generation, you are essentially talking about the human beings. So which is something which is problematic. You are not talking about other species. So that is one thing. That is, of course, a limitation. Of course, the sustainable development goal has gone beyond it. Therefore, you will find among the SDGs, there are two goals. One actually talks about the life on Earth, and other is talking about the life under the sea. And the point is, like, for example, if you see, you know, when our first prime minister, when he was appealing the people to basically give away their land for the construction of Hirakud Dam, he made a statement. I mean, people are, of course, had the fear of getting displaced, and people got displaced also. To convince them, he made a statement, if you have to suffer, you should do so in the interest of the country. So this is what actually in sustainable development also is happening. If you compare, so when you are saying the country has to be go into the development path in the sustainably, but who is suffering? Like, I work in the energy sector, I for sure know in many occasions when the, for example, a hydro dam is built, a hydro project, hydroelectricity project is made, the villages which lose the land or the villages which got submerged and displaced, those are the last one to get the electricity connection. I mean, this is what is the problem. We might say in a macro level that sustainability is ensured, sustainability in energy is ensured by tapping these natural resources, but then at the cost of one or the other is getting benefited. I mean, if you want to understand this much better, I mean, of course, one of the, you know, Professor Basuki was mentioning about Indian philosophy. In one of the philosophies of Africa, if you see, this is something which might interest you, and some of you might already know, it's about Ubuntu. So what is Ubuntu? It is the following. I mean, you might have heard this, you know, the origin of Ubuntu. In Africa, what happened, there was a Westerner who visited Africa, and he was about to leave. And when he was about to leave, he had some, you know, cookies with him and chocolates with him. So he wanted to give these cookies and chocolate to one of the children. So he said, basically, why not have a race and basically see who runs the first and reach this tree first. Obviously, the chocolates are behind the tree, and that person can have the chocolates and cookies. You know what the children did? The children actually didn't make a race. They held each other's hands, and actually they all reached the tree together and shared the chocolates and cookies among themselves. So the philosophy, if you go back to, you know, Africans' philosophy, they basically say, I am because we are. In the sense, you know, when that man, the Westerner, got puzzled, that he basically asked a girl, that why didn't you, actually you seem so athletic, why didn't you run and you could have reached the you know, tree first and got all the chocolates and cookies and you would have been happy. Then she replied, how could I have been happy if my friends would not have got any chocolates and cookies? So with others' happiness, your happiness is basically entangled to the others' happiness. So this is something which is missing in a somewhere or the other when the pursuit of sustainable development. And there where actually I think the Bhutan's approach of, you know, looking at development from the gross national happiness point of view actually is helpful. Because if you look at Bhutan's gross national happiness, they have, you know, as you see, they have 9 dimensions, and they have basically, you know, dimensions relating to ecological diversity and resilience. They have dimensions relating to good governance. They also talk about this leisure and work both. They have, of course, dimension about psychological as well as physical health, education, and they talk about cultural diversity. So the idea is, you know, the in the community aspect. So all this environmental, community, and individual aspect of development has integrated in a gross national happiness kind of index. So that can be helpful. I'll just tell about one more concept and end. The concept is basically, if you see, people talk about sustainable development in the context they say is, you know, the societies are to be you know, efficient to be, you know, to be able to achieve sustainable development. But if you see, efficiency alone actually will not lead to sustainable development. Because if you see all our systems, even the computer I am sitting here, I mean, it's a flat screen monitor, LED monitor, for instance. I mean, LED screen TV has come, that those have also become more and more efficient. But you know what has changed with the LED or the, you know, flat screen TV becoming more efficient? That means it is using less electricity, right? More efficient means it is input energy is less. So, but then what has happened? What has happened is the TV size has increased. So what does it mean? It means that is actually in energy literature, it is called as rebound effect. So once you make the system more and more efficient, what happens is people start consuming that more and more. Suppose, for example, if you have a more efficient car, then you tend to drive it more. You have more efficient TV, then the size of the TV increases. So this is what actually the concept of sufficiency is therefore important. If you see our energy, the total energy consumption that is happening in the world, if you see the energy system have become more efficient. We have largely from solid fuel like firewood to we have come to the gaseous fuel and liquid fuel, which are extremely efficient. But then our total consumption is also on the rise. And this is happening because we are using more and more. And this is what is the notion of sufficiency. Sufficiency is very important. And the sufficiency is we are unable to achieve. Of course, I talked about the rebound effect, and that's already I have explained. And the other explanation of why people are using more and more is the our crave for positional goods. The positional goods is something which is basically, so what is positional good? I mean, you might not have heard about positional goods. Positional goods is those goods. I mean, I will give an example. Like, for example, we are, you know, whatever 50, 60 of us, we are here, we are appearing an interview. And in that interview, suppose, you know, one of us, it's a summer time, and we are appearing an interview, and nobody is in coat, for instance, or a suit. Suppose one of us, like suppose, for example, I come with a suit. Then the nature of the interview is such, I am looking a little smarter with the suit, and then I wanted to, probably that increases my chances of selection slightly more. Then what happens is, suppose, you know, me wearing suit, suppose prompted everybody to go for their suit also. But now you imagine if everybody have their suit, then what happens? Then actually our chances of getting selected in the interview go back to the same probability what we started with. So all of us invested in suit, but then when everybody have it, then obviously that doesn't have any value. So this is, I mean, this suit is a good example of positional goods. Even arms and ammunitions are good example of positional goods. It doesn't matter how much arms and ammunitions India has. It matters how much it has extra over Pakistan, for instance. I mean, the day Pakistan has same as India, India would say, I don't have much, I need to have more. So this relativity actually, if you look at human consumption, this relative aspect of consumption is nothing but the positional goods aspect. And that is what is actually a kind of creating problem. And this is what was highlighted in a book by Hirtz in 1976, which was titled Social Limits to Growth. I mean, this is what is actually creating most of the problem. And therefore, the resource sufficiency, you know, is something which is more important. That how much you are using finally is more important than how efficiently you are using. And if you do that, then obviously, you know, you would be able to achieve sustainable development. I mean, this is a concept which is, you know, related to a recent concept which is coming also, which is known as degrowth. I'm not going into that, but basically this is the, you know, basically the sufficiency concept itself, that with less, how you can be happy. And that actually, you know, so basically don't grow like this, you know, in a monotonous way. You can actually degrowth and actually be happy and spend quality time in, you know, pursuing your hobbies and interest. So this is something, you know, which is for if you want to have sufficiency, have basically sustainable development. I mean, for example, when you go to a electrical shop, you get to purchase, you know, electrical appliances with star rating, and those star rating are basically efficiency star. But I think there should be also star rating for sufficiency star, so that which actually consumes less should be the one which should be given a more preference, so that the people would be incentivized to buy those. So there should be sufficiency star, not efficiency star. I mean, that's what is, you know, another way of looking at development, where you can achieve, you know, sustainable development for one and all. Thank you. Yeah, I think I took little more than what I am supposed to, but yeah, I'm done. If you have any questions, we can take it up.
Session is open for queries. Participants can unmute your mics and ask your questions or type it in the comment section.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah, sure.
Sir, I have a question. Sir, how can we overcome the controversies in the sustainable development among people? Because human development is not a development of an individual. It is people development. So how can we overcome this problem, sir?
So sorry, I could not hear the first part of the question. How can you...
Sir, how can we overcome the controversies in the sustainable development among people?
Mm-hmm. Controversy, you are saying.
Yes, sir. Because in the sustainable development, there are much controversies among people, because the individual development is not a concern for the human development. It is the development of whole society. That is the human development. So how can we overcome this controversy, sir?
No. So, well, I mean, good. Thanks for asking this question. See, in terms of conceptually, we must be very clear. So when you say it is about sustainable development, it looks like it is a development for the entire community. You are very much right. But then how as a society we respond to have a development for the community? For instance, like, for example, the town or the city which you are in, like, for example, I am at Anand. If the Anand Municipal Corporation will not develop the public transport, okay, then obviously I would tend to have my car, right? And if they develop public transport, then what might happen is I might have my car, but I might not use it, right? I might use the buses or the kind of public transport they provide. And once they provide public transport, I mean, so for example, if you go to Bombay, for instance, we have, or Bangalore, for instance, you have buses which are of AC buses, non-AC buses, you know, limited buses, which actually stops at limited stops, so as to encourage people of all kinds to avail bus services. And not only that, you need to have, you know, for example, big footpaths, so that people who go to catch buses, they are also, you know, use the footpath to reach the bus stop. Even in, for example, in UK as well as in USA, from the limited experience I have also seen there that, you know, buses have carriers for cycles also. In the sense, if you should bike to the bus stop, I mean, bike in the sense you can cycle to the bus stop, and then the bus can take your cycle at the back or at the front. There are basically, you know, there are grips to put your cycle there, and then you get down at a particular stop, take your bike, and then, you know, cycle to your home, so, or cycle to your destination. So the idea is you can do that. So the question you are asking is individual development as a community development. The community development can happen by these means. If I'm planning a city, if I'm not planning for footpaths, planning not for cycle rides, then obviously I am not planning development for the community. I am actually planning for, you know, people to have more cars. Okay. For example, you might see in many cities, people are going for a lot of, flyovers. Now, if you have a lot of flyovers, then obviously what you are trying to achieve by having a lot of flyovers, you are basically, shifting the traffic congestion from one square to the next. Okay. And then obviously you are promoting the private transport. You are basically giving a freeway to the cars, bikes, and all those things. You are not, for example, the poor public transport, the bus has to go under the flyover because there would be a stoppage under the flyover. So it cannot avail the flyover. It can go below the flyover only. So the idea is going by a flyover mode is basically giving a more, emphasis to private transport. So we have to see whether you are giving, cycle path, we are giving footpaths, or you are designing such systems where people can cycle to the bus stop and then carry the cycle in the bus so that they go to the next stop, and then so that would actually promote the cycling, and that would, by that obviously you are consuming less carbon, the carbon footprint would be low, pollution would be low, and sustainable development or environmental friendly development can be achieved as a community level. But those plannings are to be necessary. Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, good evening. I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
Sir, how can we satisfy the basic needs of people like food, shelter? How can we satisfy?
Yeah. That's a very good question again. I mean, this is something which is very important. I mean, that's what I was, towards the end of my presentation, I was coming to this positional goods. See, what happens, if you see, for example, if you compare, Scandinavian countries, like countries like Norway, Denmark, Finland, Sweden, and compare with US, for instance, you might come to know that the per capita income, is double in US compared to what you get in Scandinavian countries. But if you see the quality of life, the Scandinavian countries, the quality of life are much, much higher. I mean, you can see some of the YouTube videos, for instance, you can get to know the kind of, the kind of basic. So they have a kind of a social security system. So the social security system is the following. I mean, what exactly you said, like food, shelter, like somebody, in order to have food, shelter, clothing, or another or a few other basic needs, one need a job. But if somebody is not getting a job, then what is the security that the society is providing? That is what is the social security system. So those countries provide social security system to the people. That means at the minimum they can have their life without much problem. So that the society does. Of course, that is nothing which people would not aspire to. People would aspire to a little higher quality of life. And for that, obviously, they would be in job. It's not that with that, all people would be, but the idea there is basically people, the kind of life which you are going to value. Now, whether you are going to value a life which is more, for example, pursuing your hobbies or, having some of your interests. Suppose some of you want to learn guitar, for instance, but you could not have done that because you are in a race. Okay. Because you are in a race, probably you wanted to read one book or the other. Suppose you are a lover of Premchand or maybe Rabindranath Tagore or maybe, Ruskin Bond or maybe R.K. Narayan. I mean, you wanted to read them. I mean, you went to bookshop, you saw there is a new volume or an omnibus has come of Ruskin Bond's all laughter stories, and you wanted to read them, but you are unable to read because you are busy in certain other things. So our quality of life is getting hampered, and we are in a race towards positional goods. And what I meant by positional goods is I gave the example of suit, but to give you one more example, it is like, suppose today we have a vacation and you are going to your nearby, maybe sea beach for the vacation. Tomorrow you say, no, I mean, that's anyway, everybody is going. I want to go to Ooty, for instance. Next day you say, no, Ooty is, almost many important people of our districts have already gone to Ooty. Let me try to go to Mussoorie, for instance. Or you go to, for example, some other place next. And then you say, no, I need to have my vacation in Sydney or Switzerland or Mauritius or things like that. This is what actually is the positional goods. And that is what actually, so people are in the race towards that. And these people must realize, because positional goods actually, the as I said in the suitcase, I mean, if everybody wears the suit, then obviously suit would lose its value. Okay, if everybody would not have, you know, everybody would have decided, let's not go for suit, it is summertime, why to go for suit and spend that money? They could have spent that money in something more useful, right? So, but since everybody wanted to have that relative advantage and went for the suit, so similarly, this idea of life going in a relative way is the one which is actually is causing the problem. And that has actually, you know, made our resources to also to go in basically satisfying the luxurious needs of the rich. So if the resources would go for satisfying the basic needs of the poor, that resources is not much, that actually you can spend that resources. But unfortunately, see, you can have in a society more equity only when if your, you know, demands of the rich can be fulfilled by the, you know, fulfilled by the poor. But you know, that means, suppose in a tourism, for instance, if I go, so you might have heard about something called rural tourism. Okay, now rural tourism is people are talking about responsible tourism, ecotourism, or sustainable tourism. That is actually that when you go to certain areas and then that actually creates some kind of economic development in that area, and therefore a need of a rich is being satisfied by the poor. So in that sense, that would actually bring more equity. Suppose you want to go for tourism, but suppose you go and stay in a Taj hotel, for instance, that would actually, a rich is catering to the need of a rich. That would actually bring more inequality. So the way to go about fulfilling the basic needs of the poor is to have a society which would be having a social security system at the same time valuing life. For instance, I mean, the other, you know, question when I was answering, now suppose I stay in a campus, okay, and suppose I cycle, okay, and I derive pride out of cycle. If somebody is going by in the campus from one place to the other, from my residence to the institute, if I drive my car, one should feel ashamed about that, right? Because it is not a transport that is needed. You can either cycle or you can walk. If it is in a walkable distance, you can walk. But if you are driving a car, then obviously it is not a matter of pride or it is not a matter of prestige. It is actually a matter of shame. The society need to gear towards that. Then only the society would be able to, you know, provide the needs for the poor. I mean, which you said, providing the basic needs for the people. So we need to, you know, go towards that, right?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
There is always something to be thankful. Thanks is the highest form of thoughts, and gratitude is happiness doubled by one. Now, I request Dr. R. Surprakash Sir, Associate Dean R&D and Head UG Biotechnology, to propose the vote of thanks. Sir, please.
Thank you. Good evening to one and all who has joined us here for the webinar. At the outset, I would like to thank our beloved secretary and director, Dr. Vasugi ma'am, respected principal, Dr. Lakshmanasamy sir, for giving me this opportunity to speak to you all on this occasion. On behalf of the management, organizers of this event, students and staff members, I would like to thank our speaker, Dr. Nathan, for taking the precious time out of his busy schedule to enlighten us with this talk. Indeed, sir, like, you know, your elaborate talk, I'm definitely sure that it would have inspired our students and participants to not only sustain themselves at this present position they are at, but also to plan for future progress. I also would like to extend my thanks to the convener, Dr. Madhur Chanka sir, and the staff members of the Department of Biotechnology and Swami Vivekananda Study Circle for organizing this wonderful talk and making it a sustainable one. I am positive that this talk would have revitalized us to move forward in a positive direction and also sustain the leading position. Last but not least, I thank you all the students for showing their interest in this program And I once again like to thank everyone for making this program such a successful one. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, the organizers, for this opportunity. And I have shared my email ID in the chat box. So anybody wants to have any further sort of, you need some literature or I need to explain you something more, I'm always open to do that. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody who stayed back.
Thank you, sir. The feedback link has been posted in the chat box. Participants are requested to fill the form. It is informed that the certificate will be provided only to the participants who attend the three sessions. I repeat, the feedback link has been posted in the chat box. The participants are requested to fill the form. It is to be informed that the certificates will be provided only to the participants who attend all the three sessions. Thank you all. We will meet tomorrow for the next session at 3:45 p.m. Thank you.
See you.
In the same link.
Okay, bye bye. Take care.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, everybody. Bye. Can I leave now?
Sir, sure, sir. Sir, thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable time.
Sure, you're most welcome. Bye bye.